and welcome. Today we celebrate the Mass for the 17th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our procession this morning, let it rise. Please stand.
Thank you. Lord has said. The word of the Lord.
Also as much of the fish as they wanted. When they had had disciples, gather up the fragments left over so that nothing will be wasted. So they collected them and filled 12 wicker baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves that had been more than they could eat. When the people saw the sign which he had done, they said, "This is truly the prophet, the one who is to come into the world." Since Jesus knew that they were going to come and carry him off to make him king, he withdrew again to the mountain alone. The Gospel of the Lord. A couple of days ago, at weekday Mass, we had the reading from the book of Exodus, where Moses receives the 10 commandments from God. Passes them on to the Israelites. The 10 commandments, these 10 basic rules to follow in order to grow in holiness. And most of us probably had to memorize the 10 commandments when we were kids, you know, to acknowledge that there's only one God, to keep the Sabbath day holy, to honor the father and mother, don't steal, don't kill, don't covet, and so forth. Good rules to live by. And they also connect us in a very sacred way to our Jewish brothers and sisters. In today's second reading, St. Paul does something similar. He gives us a set of rules to live by as Christians. And so I'd like to look at those. Live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. One body, one spirit, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Those are also very good rules to live by, good commandments. In fact, I think they go hand in hand with the 10 commandments, that just as we remember the seventh day and we keep it holy, so also, as we come together, do we exercise patience, kindness, gentleness, and humility, working together for unity as one body. So how do we do that? There's an old saying that the church is always in need of renewal. The church is always in need of reform. Another way of putting it is the church is always in need of growing in love. In fact, I think that the church, as we go through it individually, we also go through that collectively. And I think that the church has been going through it for several decades now, all the way back to the Second Vatican Council nearly 60 years ago. How many people remember the pre-Vatican II church? We've got quite a few older folks here that remember it. Some of us were born after the council, so we've heard a lot of things about it. You know, I think that we continue to revisit all the time what the council meant and what is it calling us to do today. You know, I think even in this past week, we saw there's some conflict in the church about what does the council look like and how are we to live it. And as I was reflecting on today's second reading, how has the church grown in its ability to be unified and to live in humility, peace, and so forth, acknowledging one Lord, one faith, one baptism? You know, it reminded me of some experiences I had back when I used to teach in seminary. You know, I would encounter young priests, seminarians, who had a kind of romanticized view of what it looked like before Vatican II. You know, they thought that perhaps prior to the Second Vatican Council, church was in better shape, that there was greater holiness, greater love, and so forth. And I can understand how they might believe that. Back when I was in my teens and early 20s, I thought the same way, because the 1980s were a very confusing time. And I believe it is so important that in order to know where we are, we have to look at where we've been. And so with our elders here, I'd like to take a brief trip back to the 1950s, to those final years before Vatican II, and just take a look at what was it like and how was the church going. You know, in so many ways, it seemed like the church had a lot going for it. The seminaries and the convents were full. Because of the baby boom, nearly every week, somewhere in the United States, a new parish was being dedicated. Catholic schools were being built because they were bursting at the seams. You know, there's also a strong sense of identity. Everyone knew what it meant to be Catholic. Everyone knew what the church taught, because the Catechism told us. And if there were any gaps in the Catechism, Pope Pius XII was more than happy to fill in those gaps. Now, the church seemed to be in very good shape. But was it? I think a lot of our older folks here might remember that everything was not all rosy. When I first down in Alabama, that had been founded during the time of segregation. I told that story. And after Mass, one of our elderly parishioners came up to me. He said, "Thank you so much for sharing that. But one thing I want to make sure you understand, this wasn't just happening in Alabama. It was happening right here in this neighborhood. And I personally experienced it and shared with what that looked like. I just wanted to make sure I knew that this was part of the sacred story of many of our parishioners. I'm very grateful for that conversation." You know, but certainly it wasn't just about race. Back in the good old days of the church of the 1950s, there were many women in abusive marriages. We even saw their children abused. But they stayed in those marriages because there was so much pressure to stay. That to get a divorce as a Catholic, but that was a scandal. Divorced Catholics were treated like second-class citizens. They were seen as a contradiction to this idea of one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Other people also have stories to tell of those golden days that weren't always so golden. That there was an abuse crisis brewing in the church, and those who were abused and spoke up in those days weren't listened to because there was a common belief that priests and nuns could never do something like that. And then finally, the interpretation of today's second reading, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, that was pretty much limited to the Catholic Church. Now, there was certainly a strong ecumenical movement in the 1950s, but Catholics weren't allowed to be part of it. Catholics didn't pray with Protestants, and we even needed to have that special permission to go to a Protestant wedding. And in fact, while on paper it said that we recognize the baptism of Protestants, most of the time, if a Protestant joined the Catholic Church, they would have to be conditionally baptized, just in case, because there was a very common belief that probably with their theology, the Protestants had not done it right. You know, there were a lot of problems in the church, but despite all of that, the church militant was seen as strong and healthy. And so when Pope John XXIII called the Second Vatican Council, most people were caught off guard, including his own cardinals. Few people saw the problems that he saw, because on the surface, everything looked good. We were united, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. I mention all of that, not because we just need to trot out all of the old grievances that we've heard before, but Vatican II allowed the church to move in a new direction, a direction that allowed today's second reading to really be lived in a new way. I read a eulogy by John Courtney Murray, who wrote shortly after the death of Pope John XXIII back in June 1963. And John Courtney Murray said, that if there were a symbol for the pontificate of Pope John XXIII, it should be a question mark. Because Pope John was willing to ask questions, and he was humble enough not to immediately provide the answer. But he saw that from this point forward in this modern world, it was going to be important for Catholics to discern, even if that means sometimes struggling with some confusion. But we moved into new territory because of that. One Lord, one faith, one baptism took on a new meaning, that we have more in common with our Protestant brothers and sisters than anything that could possibly divide us, especially baptism and our love of Jesus. But the rest of today's second reading also was lived in a new way, that even among ourselves as Catholics, we can make room for each other despite our disagreements, that we can, in the words of St. Paul, patiently bear with one another and work for unity, even if we don't see eye to eye. The post-Vatican II understanding of today's second reading meant that people who are divorced, or gay and lesbian Catholics, or people who speak different languages, or different races, people who somehow in the past have felt alienated from the church, that there's a new invitation to be together, that God is the Father of all. I mean, if we love God and are followers of Jesus, we have more in common than anything that could divide us. That's what it means to have what St. Paul refers to as the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. That's what it means to be Catholic, because as that old saying goes, the word Catholic means here comes everyone. And the church we're living in today certainly has its own challenges. And we can see points of problems today, just as we can point to the problems of the 1950s. Seminaries were not bursting in the seams, especially in North America and Western Europe. We're all painfully aware of the struggles of many small parishes. We're also aware of ideological differences between Catholics that are extremely divisive. And we saw this past week when Pope Francis placed heavy restrictions on the use of the old Latin Mass. It's very popular in some circles. It's in all of the newspapers this past week. And I have to admit that while I agree with many of the things that Pope Francis said in his letter, he wrote what was happening, you know, I was kind of saddened by the fact that the restrictions were placed on it. Just personally, I always believe in more freedom rather than less freedom. But it points to a lot of division within the church, and it hurts. In the past few weeks, in this parish, three different very faithful Catholics, independently of one another, told me that given how so many of the bishops seem to fall politically at one end of the spectrum, they've told me they are not sure how much longer they can go to Mass, how much longer they can call themselves Catholic. And so here's my question, and here's the point of going through all of that recent history that we've done today. Here's the question. Given our problems today, how do we stay Catholic? How do we keep living this beautiful faith that our parents and our grandparents, no matter how painful it was for them sometimes to be part of the institutional church, how do we stay Catholic in these days when sometimes it is so painful for Catholics today in the institutional church? And I suggest that we're going to find the answer if we take some time this week to really sit and pray and reflect on today's second reading, which I'll briefly repeat. Live in a manner worthy of the call you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another through love, striving to preserve the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. With all of the politics, power grabs, and infighting that we see in the church today, with regular messages from this bishop or that bishop or the other theologian that some people aren't welcome in the church, despite the fact that we do hear those things even today, and some people in our own faith community feel pain because of that, the only solution that's going to keep us Catholic is to take today's second reading very seriously. And then on those days when we aren't sure we're getting anything right, then a good litmus test would be to consider the actions of Jesus in today's gospel. Are the poor being fed? For those who are physically hungry, when they walk away from us, have we fed them? And for those who are spiritually hungry, as they are walking away from us, are they walking away knowing that they are loved, that we see them as true brothers and sisters, and that they are always welcome because they are true children of God? The church of the 21st century also has a lot of unanswered questions. Maybe a good symbol for us would be the question mark. But if we're living today's second reading, and if we're living today's gospel, then the most important questions are already answered. As for the rest, we'll keep at it, but we'll know that we're doing our best follow Jesus and his teachings.
Amen.
Together, let us confess our faith.
Church, that we may work together in a spirit of unity to obtain the bond of peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Christians of all denominations, that we can learn the true meaning of the phrase, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who experience physical hunger and other forms of deprivation, that through the collaboration of people of goodwill, we may work together to end this affront to human dignity. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all grandparents, living and deceased, that the Lord may bless them and their grandchildren, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick, especially those affected by the surge in COVID cases, that people will do what they need to do to protect themselves and each other, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Myrtle Fakers, who passed away this week, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pause to place in God's hands the petitions of our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, with all of our differences and uniqueness, call us together to be one body. Help us to celebrate diversity and to be a welcoming community to all. We ask this in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice of your prayers. Glory to the Lord.
I've told things to make them holy. You never cease to gather and keep it to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, who you have summoned before you, in your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you in their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, to whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever. Thank you.
for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, send your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Put not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant to her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
Thank you.
us pray. We have consumed, O Lord, this divine sacrament, perpetual memorial of the passion of your Son. Grant, we pray, that this gift, which he himself gave us with love beyond all telling, may profit us for salvation, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If you could please be seated for just a moment. First of all, just don't forget the Legacy Civil Rights Trip in October. There's the handout on the back table next to the bulletins about how to sign up for that. If you plan to go, it's important that you let the organizers know soon, because I think they're making their final arrangements. Also, we have more flyers on the free healthcare center, which includes dental and optical, and that's the one sponsored by the Islamic and Pakistani community. And they're only, remember, called, they're only open on Sundays. Those are on the back table as well. The North City Deanery will be sponsoring a revival, which is kind of like a mission or a retreat. And they've invited Father Gerard Jordan, a very famous revivalist from New Iberville, Louisiana. And so we don't quite know where we're going to do it yet, but it's going to be somewhere in North City or North County. But it's the North City Parish is doing it. So it's Wednesday, September 8th, and Thursday, September 9th. That's going to be in the evening, starting at 6. Mark your calendars. That in the bulletin as well. Due to the increase of COVID cases and the mandate of both the City of St. Louis and now the Archdiocese here in the city, we ask that all parishioners not only wear masks here, which people are very good about doing, but also downstairs. You probably saw the email that Myrtle Favors passed away this past week. And Myrtle did not want a big funeral. And she made that very clear. Everything was written out. So there will be a visitation at Wade Funeral Home on Wednesday, August 4th, and that will be at 11 a.m. And then visitation will be for 1 hour, and then we'll go to Jefferson Barracks for a small graveside service at 12:45. Finally, don't forget to join us for coffee and donuts downstairs. And do we have any visitors today? Anybody visiting our parish? Welcome. It's good to have you with us. Do we have anyone who's back for the first time since COVID? Welcome back. The paper in the stand this match. Welcome back. Awesome. And then finally, could our grandparents here please stand? That's a lot of us. Okay. Yeah, the rest of us, let's raise our hand in blessing. God of mercy, you have given your children the gift of long life, and they ask for your blessing. Let them feel the tenderness and strength of your presence. As they look to the past, let them rejoice in your mercy. As they look to the future, may they persevere in hope that does not fade. We also pray for all our grandparents who have passed on, marked with the sign of faith. May they who loved so much on earth bask in the glow of your eternal love until the great day of reunion. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you, grandparents, for all your love.